This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the performing arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
Canada has always been well represented in the international operatic league tables. Edward Johnson, born in Guelph, Ontario, sang at the Metropolitan Opera and eventually became its director. His name is on the music building at the University of Toronto. Ben Heppner has just retired. John Vickers has just died. Both were the leading Heldon tenors of their times. Maureen Forrester and Louis Quillico had long and distinguished careers, and the present crop of international stars from Canada seems to grow larger with every passing year. When you consider that opera productions on any serious scale have only been presented in Canada for about 50 years, and that the first proper opera house was built in Toronto only a dozen years ago, it seems remarkable that the vocal talent here is and has been so deep and widespread. At the National Arts Centre, we've been lucky to perform along all of the great singers I've just mentioned, and many more besides. However, there are three great singers from the past that I would love to have shared the stage with. They happen to have been first-class artists who, for one reason or another, are not as well remembered today as they ought to be. They are Lois Marshall, Leopold Simoneau, and James Milligan. At least I was lucky enough to hear Lois Marshall in recital at the National Arts Centre back in the mid-70s. She was still in fine voice, and despite having heard some great singers in my lifetime, I can still remember what a wonderful sound she made in such a cavernous hall. It seems obvious, but sound is really important for any musician. There are many virtuosos, but it's the character and quality of the sound that sets the great ones apart from the rest. My first exposure to her singing came from the famous recording of Mozart's Abduction from the Seraglio, recorded in the early 1950s with Sir Thomas Beecham conducting. Remarkably, given the plethora of vocal talent available during that golden age, two of the principals on the recording were Canadian, Lois Marshall and Leopold Simoneau. Here she is, singing the famous showpiece aria, Martin à la Artin.
Thank you.
Lois Marshall's voice was a beautifully clear lyric soprano, but her range was considerable. She even performed the Queen of the Night, and later in her career sang songs arranged for mezzo-soprano. Even on the high notes, her voice remains full and round, and the projection is remarkably efficient, every note a pearl, so to speak. And the long runs are well managed as well. A lot of singers, sopranos included, have difficulty maintaining an even colour throughout their range and tend to get a bit tight and squeaky at the top and chesty at the bottom. It's a tribute to Marshall's vocal training that her sound is always under control and well projected. So it's not surprising that the great Toscanini, who knew a thing or two about singers, invited her to sing Missa Solemnis in New York when she was still quite young. Another aria from the abduction is Traurigkeit ward mir zum Loser, Endless Grief is Now My Portion. It shows Marshall at her dramatic best. Her voice has plenty of colour and power, not to mention incredible control in the long phrases and softer dynamics. It's worth mentioning that emotion in Mozart is much less flamboyant than in Puccini or Verdi, so the singer has to project anger, sorrow, or joy with more subtlety and within a more restricted orchestration. Nevertheless, with a singer of Marshall's caliber, it works. was a miracle that Lois Marshall ever became a professional singer. Born in 1924, she contracted polio as a young child, and although she recovered and managed to walk with leg braces, she was not mobile enough to get through opera productions. Much of her career involved non-operatic singing, including oratorios and recitals, although, as we have heard, she was able to make operatic recordings. Her most frequent accompanist, originally her coach, and later her husband, was Weldon Kilburn. Here they are together, performing the English folk song, "Drink to Me Only with Thine Eyes." I think you'd have to go a long way to hear that song sung any better. The apparent simplicity is achieved only through a complete control of vocal technique. I think if Lois Marshall had been more of an opera star, she would have made many more recordings and be better remembered today. Still, she had a long and varied career, which included a substantial amount of teaching. By all accounts, she gave generously of her gifts and experience and deserves her place in the pantheon of great singers. Leopold Simoneau, born in 1916, died in 1996. A long life and well lived. He was certainly one of the greatest lyric tenors of all time and can be spoken of in the same breath as John McCormack and Tito Skipa. He was in many ways their natural successor and performed many of the same roles. It's always a treat to hear fine singing that never goes beyond the boundaries of good taste. No sobbing, squealing, or yelling. Just a continuous stream of beautiful sound effortlessly produced. Listen to Mozart's Dalla Sua Pace from Don Giovanni and judge for yourself. One of the advantages of being a fan of vocal music, especially a broad-minded fan, like me, is that it's possible to love many kinds of sounds. You don't want to eat the same food all the time, so why listen to the same singers? Tenors come in many shapes and sizes. The old stereotype, still to be found, is sometimes nasty, occasionally brutish, and frequently short. The great ones, however, have beautiful voices, so other traits become less important. My own favorite tenors are Caruso, Melchior, Björling, Corelli, Bergonzi, Di Stefano, Wunderlich, McCormick, Skipper, Domingo, and Simoneau. I've probably left a few out. It's such a long list that the word favorite loses its meaning. They all have readily identifiable sounds, coupled with consummate vocal artistry. So what's not to like? There's an interesting story involving a discussion between two great actors, Laurence Olivier and Dustin Hoffman, who were both appearing in the movie Marathon Man. Hoffman was trying to appear exhausted, disheveled, and generally at the end of his tether emotionally, in order to prepare for a particular scene. He helped things along by not sleeping, washing, or shaving for a couple of days. When Olivier commented on his scruffy appearance, Hoffman explained his method. Olivier then suggested, "Why don't you just act?" It's a great story, and I hope it's true. And it brings me in a roundabout way to Leopold Simoneau. When you hear his voice, you are drawn immediately to the fact that he is just singing. There is no dramatic striving, artifice, or unnecessary fuss. It just seems so natural. And you want to hear more. Here's some more.
Violetta, agi per me lasciò dovizie amori e le pompose feste ova di amagia vezza veria schiavo ciascun di sua bellezza ed ho contenta in questi ameni luoghi tutto scorda per me qui presso a lei io di nascer mi sento ed al soffio d'amori generato scordo nei godi Vivo in ciel, de luce.
caso in memore. Io vivo quasi in ciel, ah sì, io vivo quasi in cielo. Io vivo quasi in cielo.
Like all Canadian singers of his generation, and even the present generation, Simoneau found few opportunities to practice his art in Canada, but enjoyed a remarkable international career working with the best singers and conductors of his time. One of his frequent partners was his wife, Pierrette Allary. They also made a lot of recordings together, and after a fairly early retirement from the operatic stage, they toured for many years, first in San Francisco and finally in Victoria, BC. Victoria has produced a number of fine singers in recent years, and I don't think it's just because the golf courses are open all year round. Not surprisingly, Simoneau performed a lot of French opera. Here is a fine example of his scrupulous art, "On ne croyait pas" from Mignon.
Je suis seul.
Pesa salire l'ombre
In my opinion, too many opera fans, especially tenor fanatics, seem to prefer the can belto type of tenor, exemplified by Mario Delmonico, or by Pavarotti at his worst. In his youth, Pavarotti had a beautiful lyrical voice and exquisite diction, but later on he became almost a caricature of himself. Light lyric tenors like Simoneau have their own repertoire, perhaps not so flashy, which requires a vocal intelligence that often seems to elude their more powerful colleagues. Simoneau was a class act and deserves to be remembered among the greats. My third singer, baritone James Milligan, will be unfamiliar to most listeners. He was born in Halifax, Nova Scotia in 1928 and died tragically young in Basel in 1961. Within about 10 years, the musical world lost Dino Lupati, Kathleen Ferrier, Guido Cantelli, Dennis Brain, and James Milligan. If you wonder why Milligan deserves to be included in such exalted company, listen to this.
Incorruptible.
I have a special love for this particular recording of Messiah made in the late 1950s with Sir Malcolm Sargent conducting. Milligan is in resplendent voice. And the trumpet soloist, Alan Stringer, was born about a mile up the road from me, although we never met. Nowadays, musicologists turn up their noses at the Church of England-style messiahs performed with large forces and little, if any, vocal ornamentation. But the solo singing on this recording is exceptionally fine, and the Huddersfield Choral Society is a first-class choir. I appreciate the importance of accurate performance practice and understand, up to a point, the musical zealots who insist upon the period instruments, herky-jerky rhythms, and ornaments so much in fashion today. But to me, the wonderful melodies written by Handel, that most vocal of composers, Italian-trained, don't forget, are often spoiled by too many dotted rhythms which are hard to sing without chopping up the vocal line. A little bit of string tone colour is okay too. Go on, call me old-fashioned. The next selection from Messiah is dedicated to anyone who may disagree.
Thank you.
James Milligan's rise to international fame was meteoric. He studied in Toronto and began his career there, often alongside Lois Marshall, who was only 4 years older. He was a soloist with the Mendelssohn Choir and performed operas in Toronto before the formation of the Canadian Opera Company, most famously as Scarpia in Tosca. He moved to England for more opportunities and quickly became a leading baritone in oratorio at Glyndebourne, and in the many high-quality Gilbert and Sullivan productions and recordings made at that time. He made his debut at Bayreuth as the Wanderer in Siegfried and became a member of the Basel Opera. All this by the age of 32. But Milligan had a chronic heart condition, and he knew he was living on borrowed time. He died of a heart attack in Basel at the age of 33. He was, as the few recordings testify, a magnificent singer. By all accounts, he also had a powerful stage presence and could have become one of the leading singing actors of his generation. If he was singing today, he would certainly give Bryn Terfel a run for his money. Here's an example of Milligan's lighter side as the Pirate King in Pirates of Penzance.
Black flag I fly, then play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well to do, but I'll be true to the song I sing and live and die a pirate. It's a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is, hurrah for the pirate king,
hurrah for the pirate king. Sally forth to seek my prey, I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king on a first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more dirty work than ever I do. For I am a pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king. It is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is, hurrah for the pirate king,
hurrah for the pirate king.
As always, these podcasts are designed to encourage the curiosity of listeners. The three singers I've chosen to put on show today deserve to be better known and celebrated for their art. If you hunt around, you'll find even more examples, which will lead you to other singers. It's a most enjoyable quest.
Imagine a vain thing. Why do the nations rage so furiously together? Why do the people imagine a vain thing? Imagine a vain. Rage together, and why do the
to the people, imagine how they think. Why do the nations rage so furiously together, so furiously together? And why do the people imagine a pain thing? Imagine a pain thing. And why do the people imagine a pain thing? The kings of the earth rise up, and the rulers take counsel together. Take counsel, take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. Against the Lord, against the Lord.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.